Everyone, and welcome to the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum. I'm Jennifer Lavasser, a curator here in the Space History Department, and I want to welcome you to our program today, What's New in Aerospace, which is sponsored by Boeing. Today we're here to celebrate Earth Day, which is coming up on Saturday. We have a very special guest to talk to us about observing space not only with astronaut eyes, but with satellites as well. So let me get to the introduction. Our guest today is a native of New Jersey, but graduated high school in Los Angeles, California. She's got a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of California, Santa Cruz, and a PhD in geology from Dalhousie University. The same year she graduated with that PhD, she was selected in the 1978 class of NASA astronauts, one of the first six women brought into the astronaut corps. She flew on three space missions in 1984, 1990, and 1992, accumulating 532 hours in space. She also served in roles at the Center for Science and Industry in Columbus, Ohio, on the National Science Board, and most recently as Chief Scientist and Administrator of NOAA. She's also a captain in the Navy, was a captain in the Navy Reserve, and has a lifelong interest and passion for the study of Earth and its oceans, and using her own eyes and those of satellites to help us understand it better. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kathy Sullivan.
Thanks.
So I just want to mention from the outset, we are here to talk about Earth Day today, but we know many of you are going to have questions about life as an astronaut, and we welcome you to ask those earlier in the program, and then we'll move through a little bit more of the science talk as we go through. But if you do have questions, you're welcome to sit in the back row over there and get ready for questions. We'll have a Q&A period at the end of each segment that we do, and we're going to get started talking a little bit about, Kathy, your experience as an astronaut and what you viewed from space.
Well, thanks, Jennifer. It's delightful to be here with all of you. You know, I think probably the best way to share that is to show pictures. We always joke that we come back with the world's best vacation pictures, and people even flock into the room to see our vacation pictures. I say, I won't run when they try to show your vacation pictures, right? But let's just run some of those. We're not going to try to explain everything in each of these scenes. We just sort of mean to tantalize and excite you and show you some of the beauty and wonder of looking out the spacecraft window at Earth. And for those of you curious, as Jennifer said about living in space, there's some interior shots from the space station in particular as well. So let's go ahead and get started with that. The couple of points that strike astronauts always, this is where my life as an astronaut or my dream of an astronaut started. It was all about maps, and it was always about understanding the Earth that we live on. I grew up watching these guys do this amazing adventure and bring back pictures like that that showed that we actually live on this little marble, this little beach ball, out in the middle of the blackness of space. It was a stunning thing to have happening when I was in high school. And as Jennifer said, not long after graduate school, I joined the space program and set off on this voyage. This is riding a bomb, whether it's a space shuttle or any other booster that's going to take you off the Earth. It's millions of pounds of thrust to push you off the planet. Our gravity field is very strong. It's hard to take that first step. But you go from 0 miles an hour in Florida to 17,500 miles an hour in just 8.5 minutes. And unsurprisingly, the view out your window becomes pretty dramatic, really very fast. That's me on the left and Dave Liesma on the right, waving to our crewmates as we did a spacewalk in 1984. And you'll notice I wave a little bit and I right away go back to looking at the Earth. That's how mesmerized I always was about it. That's me on the left, and that's Venezuela sliding behind the tail of the orbiter as we were completing one of the jobs on our spacewalk. And it feels like you're hanging from a jungle gym looking at the grass beneath your feet at a moment like that when you see a sight like that go by. But feast your eyes on these sorts of scenes. This is a panorama from the space station. You're orbiting a beach ball. It's very clear to you it's a beach ball. And you saw maybe that thin blue haze on the preceding scene and that faint green line here. That's a really strong reminder of how thin our atmosphere really is. It's more like an eggshell or a tangerine peel. It's just it's a film, it's a membrane that envelops the planet. Colleagues of mine now live on this thing for 6 months at a time. I'm hugely jealous. Every time anybody cites my 530 hours in space, I feel it's a paltry number compared to what they get to do. And they have these amazing views out of the cupola, for example, which is sort of the 360-degree picture window on the space station that gives them fabulous views of the Earth. When you spend 6 months at a time in something like this, and Peggy Whitson, who's up there now, is on her third expedition, you know, you see seasons change, you see landscape patterns shift, you see all sorts of crazy things. Here are a couple of scenes of what it's like living inside the space station. I think a simple summary is imagine your worst closet at home as big as a football field. And then imagine the challenge of showing up for your turn on the space station and having to find out where the fresh food and the clean socks are. The storage problem, as you can suspect here, is really pretty immense. The other thing to think about this space station, two to six people have been living in this space station since 1998. That's 19 years of people living permanently off the planet. And to think about the science knowledge and the engineering knowledge it takes to recreate in spacecraft systems the life support capability that we have on this planet. You have to think about how you make water. You have to think about conserving water. You have to think about reusing water. And you know, really, we need to do that too. Everything you see in these Earth scenes behind you, everything you see in them that is blue and white is water. And I think if you watch them for a while, you'll be struck, as many of us are, from orbit. We probably named the planet wrong. We call it Earth, but most of it is not dirt. Most of it is water. Water in the ocean is the bulk of that, but water in clouds and ice and snow and a little bit of water on the planet that's actually fresh water. So it is, as Jennifer said, it is a system of systems. You can't talk about fresh water supply for human beings if you're not thinking about the ocean, because the ocean is the pump that pumps the circulatory system, that makes the clouds, that makes the rain, that feeds the water that we depend on. So it's a pretty remarkable little blue marble that we live on.
Well, that's a fabulous way to get us going into some conversation about your experiences. You're a trained geologist, an oceanographer. What did you have any expectations going into your first flight of what you might see, what your eyes could tell you about seeing the Earth?
You know, I had pored over, I think, every single photograph that any other astronaut had ever taken, from the close-up ones with a telephoto to the big panoramas. There were a few regions of the world that had always fascinated me geologically, so I'd paid extra attention, for example, to the Himalayas or the Tibetan Plateau. But you know what you can't be prepared for, and thank heavens, I don't want anyone to figure out how to prepare you for this, is that difference that we all know from our own experience. It's the difference between looking at a picture of your friend's wedding and being in your wedding, or looking at someone else's picture from their vacation in Hawaii or at the Grand Canyon, and standing at the edge of the Grand Canyon yourself. The experience is different. That's who we are as human beings. And so I could not really prepare for. I was intellectually really ready to see things and spot things and make sense of them. But literally 8.5 minutes into my first flight, when I lifted my eyes off the instrument panels and looked through those forward windows for the first time, and we're inverted, so the Earth is up here, this big blue and white arc. And it was so stunning, I blurted out unintentionally, you know, wow, look at that. And our commander, my boss, you know, right away said, no, not yet. We still have checklist things to do. And I figured, great, it's 8.5 minutes into my first flight and I've ruined my career already.
You mentioned looking at photographs and using those to prepare yourself. How did you prepare for actually taking photographs? I mean, I've heard many astronauts say that this is, in particular, Gene Cernan talked a lot about using photographs to convey that experience. And so did you go through a lot of training? How did you sort of get ready for bringing that message back?
Well, I happen to be lucky to have grown up the daughter of a very good amateur photographer myself. So I'd been around cameras. My high school jobs were selling cameras in different stores. Running the dark room with my dad. That's not true for everybody, though. And so we did actually, by the time we came along in our group, there actually was some quite formal photo TV training, really oriented around providing the engineering documentation of the things you're doing on the flight. But also NASA, in collaboration with Smithsonian, runs a network of observations, the Smithsonian Earth Alert Network. And so we also tied into that, and we would have a list of sites or features or phenomena on the Earth that scientists around the planet might have given to Smithsonian to request that you get some astronaut photography to complement whatever other data they had. So we had that. On my first flight, our boss, Bob Crippen, was he was very much into, you know, do the engineering documentation, and would commonly say, no, no, no art, you know, no time for art, just do the straight photography. I'm delighted to see, as I look at the photo archives and the blogs of space station astronauts nowadays, that has clearly shifted to being a richer mix of motivations, I think, mainly on part of the astronauts, but even on NASA's part, to realize there is something important and valuable also about conveying the experience, the broader sense of place that some of those panoramic shots give you, for example,
sure.
And that, you know, just a close-up on a river or a city doesn't give you the same sense of. But those two different shots, I will just make one other comment. One of the things that's really magic about being there yourself is, you know, at will, you could shift from looking as closely at some detail as you want, or pulling your focus back and seeing, you know, all of the Himalayas, or looking right down and just seeing the summit of Everest and focusing it detail at that.
So thinking about the different places that you actually look at, what are some of the environmental conditions or factors and changes in the Earth's surface that you can actually see? I've seen recently a photograph of, and it may be one that you actually shot on one of your missions, of somewhere where you could actually see smog. Mm-hmm. over a coastline or something like that. So let's talk a little bit about, or tell us a little bit about what you can see that's sort of a human factor, a
sure.
human environmental effect.
Well, you see both natural and man-made phenomena, of course. And so you can see short-term things. We, on several flights, see volcanoes erupt or forest fires burning, things like that. One of my colleagues, Frank Culbertson, was in orbit when the attacks happened on September 11th. So you can see those things. Crews were in orbit during the first Gulf War and saw the smoke plumes coming off the oil fields in Kuwait. Astronauts through time, both individually and collectively, see other longer term changes as well. You talk to folks that flew back in the early Apollo and Mercury days and compare that to what we see now in the Amazon basin, for example. Astronauts as well as satellites have watched, you know, the Amazon get cleared progressively and turned into from rainforest into agricultural and other uses. The Aral Sea is a famous one that has been observed from space again by both astronauts and satellites, shrinking tremendously over decades. There's almost nothing. It's shocking to me to see today's images of it just compared to my last flight in 1992. A lake like Lake Chad, a sort of evanescent lake in northwest Africa that pulses with the monsoons. And I think every astronaut that flies looks at that. It's got sort of a sort of odd blob shape and a little bit deeper spot in the south, and how much water is in the south and can you see the sand dunes poking through is a scientific and an environmental change question for us. It's a survival question for the nomadic people that live in that region that are counting on the little bit of water or the little bit of vegetation that they could grow.
Interesting. Well, I think we have a couple minutes. If we've got a few questions right now from some of our audience members. For Dr. Sullivan, go ahead.
Hi, I was just wondering, what is the application and selection process like to become an astronaut, especially coming from the Navy?
Yeah, so it's NASA's looking still for people with a good body of academic preparation and experience in science and technology. It's still really an engineering enterprise just living on the station. And if you're living on something like the space station or flying the vehicle, you're it. You know, you're the repairman, you're the operator, you're the cook, you're the cleaner, you're everything. So you want to get a really good grounding in school, start as early as you can, thinking about doing well in school as a staircase to where you want to get to. You'll probably need an advanced degree in a scientific or a technical field. And then NASA will usually be looking for you to have already had some experience applying that, because that's where they'll see something about your character, your strength, your perseverance, those sort of personal traits that they're looking for. In the last cycles, close to 19,000 people applied. They're down to looking at the last 50, and they'll probably pick about 5.
Thank you.
I wanted to know if, in the outer space, it was dark. So if it's just the Earth that gets lighter or if it's just the outer space in the daytime that gets lighter?
That's a great question. So our sun is a really bright star, And anytime you are anywhere where you can see the sun, it will cover you in light. But if you're orbiting in a space shuttle, let's imagine this is the Earth, and you're the sun. So if I'm orbiting in a space shuttle, when I'm over here, I can see you and I'll be in the sunlight. But when I get back here, the Earth is gonna block the light. So on a space station or a space shuttle, it takes 90 minutes to go all the way around. And for 45 minutes of that, I'll be able to see you and I'll be bathed in sunlight, but then back here, I'll be in shadow. So it's both light and dark in space, depending on whether something's blocking the sun. Good question.
Hi, first, it's an honor to meet you and an honor to have you here. As people are going into becoming an astronaut, especially females, I was wondering if you had any advice for fellow females and fellow people looking to become astronauts themselves.
You know, I honestly don't know of anything that I would say is strongly gender specific about the role of astronaut. It really is about expertise, knowledge, competency, and the sort of character that lets you perform at a high level. On a good day and on a day where maybe things are going a little bad or maybe you're feeling a little down, it's, you know, you're the beneficiary of so much of your country's treasure. You're in a very special place. It's very valuable time to have people there to do anything, and so it really is make the most of that experience. But the other reality is I can tell you what it took for Kathy Sullivan to go do that. I can't tell you what bits were particular to things I found easier, things I found challenging that were because I'm a woman. I can tell you things that I can see from my background or where my academics were thin. But so I've never really quite known how do you answer the, you know, what's different about being a female astronaut. It's a different challenge for each individual depending on their background, their character, their skills, and what they bring to it.
Thank you.
We'll do one more question right now, and then we're going to talk a little bit more about observing. Go ahead.
Hi. Thank you for sharing.
Can you come a little closer to the mic? Thanks.
Sure. I don't want to be too loud. Hi, I'm Allie, and thank you for sharing your experiences and being an inspiring American figure and a woman. I have a soil restoration company, and I'm just curious about what your experience has been in terms of seeing the Earth. You know, we look at it from a water conservation and a repurposing, but what does it look like from space over time for the soil and the land of the Earth?
Well, that's actually a great segue to the next segment and some of the things that we're going to talk about there. So can I postpone the question a little
bit?
I think we'll probably come out in our next line of discussion.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Thanks.
So to backtrack a little bit and sort of move on to our next topic, when you talked a little bit about the rest of your crew and the rest of the how seeing Earth does something many astronauts or people call the overview effect. Seeing Earth from space can have a fundamental change, and it can change you. Did it have an effect on you as a group, as a crew in space? Did you talk differently or communicate in a certain way?
Yeah, I think that change is very real. It's got multiple dimensions to it. One specific point, one of the guys I flew with on my first flight, I flew with again 6 years later. And on my first flight, he's all engineering. He's got lots of things to do. Get this photography training out of the way. Get this earth science training out of the way. It's a bother. 2 minutes after we get into orbit, he suddenly needs to know everything about the Earth. And he's got me, the resident geologist, and Atlas right nearby. So he's forever pulling me over. What's this? What's this? Where is that? On our third flight together, we were the experienced folks. We had three rookies aboard. And he was suddenly the counselor to all the rookies, saying, no, 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 do more of this Earth Obs training. You're going to really want this. So the experience does grab you. Seeing the planet that way as a whole, really being unable to avoid seeing the multiple interconnections at different scales. Noticing that you see both whole continents, it's sort of a yin and a yang. Yes, you see whole continents and sort of forget about many of the divisions or tensions that you hear about every single day here on Earth. But at the same time, you also see the hand of man. So it's kind of a both and. It gives you a very idealistic sense of unity and wholeness and interconnectedness on one level. And also shows you signatures and symptoms that remind you that we are a very purposeful species with tremendous capability to focus our own energy and other energies. And when we do that, we leave significant fingerprints on the planet.
So we're going to move on a little bit to observing in another way, which is observing with certain kinds of tools, not our own eyes as the observer, but looking through the eyes of tools, electronics, satellites. We have a little video that you're going to talk a little bit about here, and then we'll get chat a little bit more.
So one of the, by my third flight, a really rising motivation for me was to take these great, you know, astronaut pictures, vacation pictures as I call them, but I wanted to make them matter. I mean, I don't want to just go showing slides for the rest of my career and you know, giving dinner table talks. And it takes measurements like these, measurements that engineered sensors on satellites can make, that quantify, in this case, how much water vapor and moisture is in that storm. That's going to go into the computers and become a real worthwhile calculation, how much rain is going to fall on the land that that storm runs over. Being able to see the ocean circulate or water vapor in the atmosphere, you see a hurricane spinning up off of Mexico here in the greens and oranges. Being able to see the water vapor in the atmosphere, not just see it, but these measurements, these are actually quantitative measurements. And that ability, it's always satellites plus in-situ measurements, by the way. Satellites are not magic things that do this all by themselves. But you just saw in that beautiful color pattern, ocean currents overlaid with temperature. So where's the hot and cold water and how is it swirling? To be able to watch and monitor over time, this is over a decade and a half, the extent of Arctic ice, watching temperatures, the difference from the average through decades at a time. This is new. This capability to snapshot the whole planet at once is new since the space age. We're the first human beings ever in history that have it. And when you add that to computing capability, this is what gives us something I call foresight or environmental intelligence. The trivial form of that that we all know is the weather forecast, right? Why did you know to have jackets on? Why did you think to bring an umbrella? Because it's possible nowadays to say something meaningful about what downtown DC will be like 24, 48, 72 hours, 5 days out. In 1850, a gentleman in Parliament commented that someday it might be possible to know what London would be like in 24 hours. He was laughed out of the room. We now make some use of 10-day weather forecasts. We've watched as here's the satellite view of the Amazon being cleared through time, a result of a conscious and constructive policy on the part of the Brazilian government to settle their frontier and provide food and population settlement. So you watch these changes, but when you monitor them with satellites instead of just watching them with our eyes, we can quantify them, we can combine them with other knowledge, we can combine them with census or statistics or business dynamics. That little dark splotch was just a solar eclipse going across the Earth, by the way. So these are the things that are really bringing tremendous new capability to our world. You can see a dust storm like this as an astronaut, but now we can translate that with satellite measurements into detailed measurements and predictions that will give you a quantification of how much will the sunlight be damaged or decreased, how will that affect the growth rates in the Amazon. Dust from the Sahara does affect growth rates in the Amazon and is an important contributor to the agricultural viability of Brazil. So that's how interconnected our planet is.
We're going to have some photographs from or some video here from the International Space Station just going by as we continue to talk. But I want to ask, in consideration of what you've experienced, what does Earth Day mean to you?
For me now, Earth Day is like many other holidays. It's a day on the calendar, a mark on the calendar that reminds me to stop and really think about this planet we live on. What it provides for us, what do we know, what do we have yet to learn about how it functions, and to do at least my own little checklist of whether I'm on track in the ways that I can be to help contribute to making sure we understand it better, we get that information in useful forms, useful to business leaders, useful to natural disaster and emergency officials. My interest is not just to have a scientific understanding of the Earth that's in scientific journals. My interest and the reason I always ended up at NOAA instead of at NASA is because NOAA is really where this kind of knowledge and information gets put into action and really comes to be a value in everyday life. One of our big box retailers, for example, takes NOAA weather data at the beginning of each week and mashes it up with a lot of other things, including 400,000 product codes. And they, every single week, are using that to drive their ordering, their supply chain, their in-store placement, and their media buys. So this kind of foresight about conditions on the Earth increasingly are also driving into making our economy more effective and more efficient.
So we saw an image at the beginning of the last video of satellites circulating the Earth. How many satellites does just even maybe NOAA have available? Clearly there's a lot of space to cover. There's a lot of the Earth to cover.
Yeah.
What are the tools and sort of what are their capabilities?
Yeah, this is not something that any one country can do on its own. It takes tens of billions of measurements just to make a basic weather forecast. And so what's evolved over decades is each country does what it can do within its means, and everyone shares all the data. So U.S. weather forecasts get fed with data from NOAA geostationary satellites and NOAA polar satellites, but also a handful of NASA research satellites, some Japanese satellites, and some European satellites. And the measurements like of ice caps or forest clearing are made by more imaging sensors, again, on a fleet of satellites that are now European and Japanese, even Chinese, Indian, so many, many countries. And the so far recognition has been that the best way to support both global economies and global citizens is treat those data as global public goods. They're like an open innovation platform. Anyone can have those data, no barrier to entry. You can build your own new app with it. You can do a research project with it. It can feed your National Weather Service, because that's the only way. You have to be measuring the whole Earth to really have any of this knowledge. So let's collaborate on the measurements, and then we can each make our own benefits out of it.
Let's turn back to a few more questions. I see we've got a pretty full row back there.
Cool.
So we'll get some more young people up here to ask some questions. Hi there.
Hi. I wanted to know, like, what does space food taste like?
That's a question I like to know
yes.
about too.
It's actually a lot like camping food, because you know water is actually very heavy. So the first thing you want to do if you want to take up a lot of food is take all the water out of it, and then you add water to it in orbit. So you could go to an REI kind of store or backpacking store, and buy some of the food they sell to mountaineers and to campers. NASA even uses some of those commercial foods, and then some other kinds of foods it prepares, but the same way in its own kitchens. So it's pretty good. But if you get to play in zero gravity and look out the window with that amazing view for a week or a couple months, most of us are willing to put up with the food not being like the best ever. You can come home to the best ever food, but you're not going to get that anywhere on Earth.
Did you have a favorite food in space?
My favorite drink was orange mango, and believe it or not, my favorite food was shrimp cocktail. And it actually is shrimps dehydrated in dehydrated cocktail sauce, and they rehydrate to be shrimps. And because it's space, you can put your shrimp right there, and it will just stay right there. And if you tap it gently, you can make it spin like a spin-stabilized
wow.
satellite. And then the easy way, once you have it there, the easy way to eat it is not to try to catch it with a spoon, but you just open your mouth and glom it like a goldfish.
And you're defying the idea of not playing with your food right
now,
there.
Your parents will forgive you for playing with your food, provided it's in zero gravity. Don't try this at home.
Right. Hi there.
How many missions did you go on?
I got to go on three different missions, and they were 5 to 10 days long, each one different. And probably the most famous one for you would be the one that put the Hubble Space Telescope into orbit. So if you go another gallery over, you'll see a full-size model of the Hubble Telescope that we used to practice some of our engineering, because it's the one that's klutzy enough that we could practice on it. They didn't want us to practice on the real one.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi there.
I have two questions. First question is, did all of you get inspired by just one thing all together? The whole team got inspired by something like the sun setting or going up?
You mean being inspired to become an astronaut?
No, like you all thought something was beautiful.
Oh, I see. Okay. And what's your second question?
How much time does it take to get into space from Earth?
Yeah, it takes 8.5 minutes to get into space, because being in space means two things. One, it means you have to get a certain height. You have to get more than 60 miles above the Earth. That's just what people have declared as being in space. So you got to get 60 miles high or higher. But to be in orbit means you're going a certain speed. So you have to accelerate to 17,500 miles an hour. Then you'll be going so fast that you'll stay in orbit. If you went slower, you just go on a big arc and fall back to Earth. And what we got inspired about was a little different on each different flight. I think one thing that each of my crews had in common was we really came together. We had a list of jobs we had to do, and we were very interested in all of them and really committed to doing a good job on all of them. So we all came together around that. And I think we all came together around loving to look out the window and see the Earth. And playing in zero gravity, like I said, is really very fun. So we also had a lot of fun times together doing that. Good questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Sure.
Is weightlessness a little bit like buoyancy?
That's a really good insight. We use the concept of neutral buoyancy in a water tank to practice for weightlessness. So if I put you in a spacesuit, that's like putting you in a bubble of air. Then I'm going to hang a lot of lead weights on the outside. I'm going to take you in a big swimming pool. And if I've gotten all the lead weights on you exactly right, if I hold you in that swimming pool and let you go, you'll stay right there. You won't sink, you won't pop to the surface, and you also won't tip. And so that's what we do to practice spacewalks. We don't use that to try to practice working in zero G just in a shirt sleeve environment, because people pick that up very quickly. But it's a bit like scuba diving if you've gotten your weights balanced just perfectly. And that's where the idea of buoyancy comes in. You have to have that buoyancy neutral, not popping up and not sinking. Good insight.
I only have one question.
That's okay.
What is space?
What is space?
Ooh, that's deep.
Yeah, that's a good question. So, yeah, that's the label we give to what's outside of the atmosphere of a planet. So that's the vacuum. There's no air there. There's still some stuff there, but there's not enough stuff for us to breathe. There's not enough stuff for our body to stay healthy, because our body needs pressure around it as well as air to breathe. So it's just everything that's not inside the atmosphere of a planet is what we call space.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I just wanted to know if it's true that NASA, every single week, they launch a new satellite?
No, the launch rate for NASA is not anything like once a week. They launch space station crews every couple of months. They launch a resupply every couple of months. They launch satellites for other agencies. So when NOAA needs a satellite in orbit, it's actually NASA that organizes the launch, because that's something NASA has special expertise on. But I would say it's more like once a month or every other month, certainly not once a week. And it's not the same year to year.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right.
One more?
I think we got one more for now.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you sleep in space?
Yeah, you know, you have to sleep in space, just like here. But what's really cool is there's so many ways that you can sleep. One is you literally could just close your eyes and right where you are, fall asleep. And you would drift around in the air. Because even here, although we don't feel it, the air is circulating through this room a little bit. And if you go really asleep and motionless, you would just drift slowly around. Sometimes you get in a space shuttle, we had things that were basically sleeping bags, and some folks like to get in those, but they didn't have to be on the floor. They could be on the wall, they could be on the overhead, or they could just be tied off at one end and dangling away. And in the space station, because people are there for longer, they each have a little bit of a cubicle. And it would look really super small to you, but you would be looking at it thinking, you know, I need a chair and I need a bed, and you don't need a chair or a bed when you're gonna live in space because you can just float in there any way you want. I had one of my flights, I had a bunk bed, but it was about this high. It looked more like a small linen closet. But that didn't matter because in zero gravity you don't toss and turn. You don't have to roll over. And by the way, in zero gravity nobody snores if you want to know the really good deal.
Ooh. That sounds great.
Great question. Thank you.
And I would say too, we have a sleep pallet, a little sleeping bag inside our space shuttle over here. So make sure you go take a look at it.
Yep.
Awesome. Well, we'll move to our last segment now, which really is sort of thinking a little bit more about how we apply what we know to the future. How are things going to go in the future? You talked a little bit about using data to predict what's going to happen. So tell us a little bit more about how that, what we're gathering can be informative and what we can expect coming down the road.
Yeah, so we've touched on a little bit of this, but let me give maybe the ideal example. So over the years, scientists from many nations have put an array of buoys across the Pacific Ocean, dozens of them, like 60 or 70 of them, that have sensors that measure down to about almost 1,000 feet in the water column and up to about 300 feet in the air. Because the way that the ocean and the atmosphere interact turns out to be really critical to determining what our weather patterns are going to be on time scales of a couple of weeks out to a couple of months. And the way the temperature or pressure in the Pacific is really what drives whether we have an El Nino or the opposite cycle of a La Nina. So if you take those buoys, which send all their measurements, you know, dozens, hundreds of times a day, they send all their measurements via satellite back to NOAA, which collects them. And then you take other satellites that can measure the surface temperature of the ocean over essentially the whole planet almost simultaneously. You mash those pieces of information up. You add basic knowledge of physics, how things circulate, and I'm showing you some of the kinds of products, information products that you can make from some of these satellite measurements with other data on this sort of rotating orange peel. When you bring those things together, that's what has produced the capability to start to give 60 and 90 day outlooks about temperature and precipitation, which matter tremendously to agricultural interests, matter tremendously to disaster planning interests. So if you look at a FEMA, or you look at large agricultural concerns or national governments that have real challenges of food security, that's where that kind of information goes. Focusing a little more specifically, NOAA with NASA and some other partners used that blue marble look that you see going on there and the biosphere one that you see here, took data like that, put them together, and focused on the four staple crops that feed most of the world's population: maize, corn, wheat, maize, rice, wheat, and cassava. And most of the world's food security problems in Asia and Africa really are where populations are dependent on those crops. Well, what would happen before these products got put together? There'd be a crop failure. Government would only know when the crop was failing, because there's not going to be enough food. By the time they would turn to try to buy a replacement on the markets globally, the prices would have risen because of the crop failure. So now they don't have enough food to feed their people and don't have enough money to buy the food to feed their people. In 2009, NOAA gave that kind of information and the training of how to use these models to the government of India. The government of India now gets an outlook 90 days ahead about the monsoon and how that's going to affect the wheat crop. I don't mean like 100% prediction. I just mean an indication that lets them know likely to have a monsoon or not likely to have a monsoon. But that's enough for the government to decide to hedge its food risk. And so they will preemptively go buy wheat futures when the price is low enough that they can afford them. So it's global. It's a global climate model. It's basically a climate dynamics model that's taken the government of India out of the spot market for wheat and made it possible for them to feed their people even when there's a failed monsoon coming. But, and that's just one of, you know, I could give you dozens of other examples.
So looking at this image of a rotating Earth and different kinds of data that are being gathered, and you've had experience in sort of communicating science to the public, obviously. What are some effective ways that we can kind of keep up this dialogue and really give this, send these messages about how we're affecting our Earth to the public?
You know, we found at NOAA that focusing on the value of take the pulse of the planet and translate that into what we called environmental intelligence, you know, actionable and timely information that's pertinent at the time and space scale to some decision that some real world person is facing. The Prime Minister of India, the head of American Airlines trying to manage their route system when thunderstorms are popping up over Dallas, the government of Canada with a snowstorm coming through the eastern provinces. These are happening all the time everywhere. IBM bought the weather company recently for a multi-billion dollar price tag because they recognize that this kind of weather and climate information, what's the weather going to be, what's the temperature going to be, what's the water going to be, where's it going to be, is of increasing importance through all layers of society. And the science is now absolutely at that point where it is actionable, it is reliable. It's not plopping some science on the table does not make a decision for someone, but as a factor in a decision, it's a very valuable contribution to making a wiser decision. My phrase has always been, this is about having the information that helps us live wisely and well on this planet. That certainly can mean understanding where we should look at conservation or restoration of the natural environment. Certainly can mean looking at where we can easily could lessen our own footprint on the planet, but also has to do with where we've got hazards and conditions coming at us that we need to be prepared for.
Great. I think we'll throw to a few questions right now. I could see another full row of folks ready to ask.
Did you get close to any asteroids while you were in space?
Happily, we did not get close to any asteroids while we were in space because they could really wreck our spaceship. But no, they tend to graze by the Earth very quickly, and the shuttle and station are both in quite a low orbit. So they're usually quite far away from asteroids. Cool. So little bits, micrometeorites, sometimes those go by, and sometimes they'll ding or make a hole in the spaceship, but small ones, happily.
Thank you.
You bet.
I am a science educator, so I spend a lot of time explaining concepts to people. And I was curious, for the work that NOAA is doing and for everything that, for all of the information that's being gathered and what we're trying, the difference we're trying to make with it, what is a concept that you have found the most challenging to help the general public understand?
We're talking about a really complex system of systems. And I think part of the challenge is, as a scientist or an explainer, is trying to recognize for any given audience or any given question or decision, how much of that complexity really matters. NOAA produces 20 terabytes of data a day. None of you need those 20 terabytes of data. But many of you really value some little dollop of the data that's in the form of information, not data. So trying to understand what that construct is, what's that size and shape that of information that's pertinent to the audience at hand, I think is really the trick.
Thanks.
Those of us that are dazzled by the complexity and just love it need to get over ourselves.
What's your opinion on a manned mission to another planet?
Love this question. My opinion about a manned mission to another planet is that I don't think there's any goal or any objective that would do a better job of catalyzing tremendous scientific and technical advance across a huge array of fields, and that would succeed at getting someone, say, to Mars. But that would also generate a cascade of benefits right here on Earth that I don't think we would come near getting if we tried to aim at each one of them independently. We did Apollo, we went to the moon. And some folks would say, yeah, great, what did we get out of that? Apollo jump-started digital computing. If you have an iPhone, you're living with the successor of the spurt that Apollo, and it was a big enough spurt that a lot of people in a lot of different sectors could say, wow, if they can do that now, you know what I could do in my field? You know what I could do with cars? You know what I could do? And so it spread out and became much more widespread and started to evolve in other places. We're gonna have two guys walking around on the moon, for crying out loud. How do we know if they're alive? How do we know if they're getting overexerted? We gotta monitor their heart rate. They're gonna be 200,000 miles away. How are you gonna do that? We'll figure it out, and they did. And today, if you had a car accident and the ambulance picked you up, they would put electrodes on you and be sending medical signals to the hospital while they were rushing you there so that your emergency team would already be started on the case before you even arrived. That's called telemedicine. It started with Apollo. So these bursts like that that would have huge ripple effects through our society, through our economy, through our well-being, I don't know of any better way to get a big batch of them than set a big, audacious goal that involves taking humans. And then don't blink and actually go do it.
We have another question.
Given all the information.
Sorry, say that again. The planet's going to be just fine. This planet's going to continue on. But the dynamics of the systems on the planet are definitely changing in ways that we have not seen in recorded human history. We've not seen these rates. And as far as we know, we've not seen them back for 800,000 years, as well as we can tell in any of the proxy records. So what's never happened before is this rate of change and these patterns of change with 7.5 billion people living in highly structured societies and economies. These changes are going to be disruptive. But it's a fair debate, and it's not actually really a scientific debate. There's a policy debate you can have about whether you want to take economic measures to lessen the carbon impact that the human race is having. It's unequivocal that we are injecting carbon into the system. Does it matter? Do you care about it? Do you want to take policy measures? Fair debate. But the changes are happening. The changes are recordable. They're evident all around you. It's just data. And lots of trends are moving in directions that are going to undercut, that are going to overturn the assumptions on which we've built businesses and communities and stable societies. We should be thinking about that. We should be thinking ahead about how to adapt and be prepared for the turbulence that's likely to cause. Hi there. What's your question?
Is it hot?
Is it hot, like in space or inside the spaceship, or both? Both. So it's really hot in space if you're in direct sunlight, like 255 degrees hot, super hot. And if you get behind something and you're in a shadow, then it also gets super cold. But inside the spaceship, both the space station and the space shuttle, we know how to build heating and refrigeration systems. And you basically have a dial like you have at your house, and you can set a thermostat and make it be as warm or cold inside as you need it to be. Just kind of just like your house, but a little more complicated.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Great.
Good question.
So to kind of bring this back to Earth Day and thinking about observations in different ways, are there ways that the public can get more involved in not only understanding the data? Are there places the public can go to learn more about this, and sort of what are the tools that we might use as sort of non-scientists to really engage with some of this material?
Yeah, there are a couple that come to mind. NOAA packages and pulls a lot of this information together along thematic lines of oceans or coasts or weather and climate, so you can take a look through those lenses. NASA has a website called the Earth Observatory that's a pretty good compendium. If you want to sort of shop around and see what kind of images, what kind of visualizations are there. Then there are things like Google Earth Engine or nonprofit organizations that focus on different resources. World Resources International, for example, has pulled together a lot of different map-based information. So that's a good, pretty encyclopedic place. They've assembled a Global Forest Watch. They've been working with a lot of organizations to put together a Global Fish Watch. So there's an increasing number of places that are trying to create really usable platforms for people who want to explore some of the data, see what's out there, whether just as curiosity about the data and about satellites or through a lens that interests you, like I said, like forests or agriculture or oceans.
Great. Wondering if we have maybe a couple more questions from the audience. I think we may have at least one.
From a tall guy.
Hi, I'm David Dvorkin. I'm curator of astronomy. And my question is, in the time that you've been with us so far, what kind of work have you been doing? What are your goals?
Here?
Yeah.
Ah. So yes, I am actually at Smithsonian as a fellow in aerospace history at the moment. And I'm not working on the Earth right now. But I mentioned I was on the crew that put the Hubble Space Telescope into orbit. And the bulk of our job in the years leading up to that was actually to make sure that every tool and every repair procedure needed to be able to fix the Hubble in orbit was ready and in place and had been tested and, in fact, proven out on the actual Hubble telescope. So a small team, another astronaut and me, and a very small handful, like maybe a dozen engineers at NASA centers and at a couple contractors, for 5 years, worked on making sure that the Hubble repair manuals and toolkits were there and were ready, and we could put our hands in the air and say, I promise you all this stuff is going to work. Well, that little story, you know, lots been written about Hubble's astronomy, and lots has been written about the drama of the servicing missions, but how the general idea of let's just go fix this turned into the actual ability to do it, and the high confidence and reliability that was needed to make sure the telescope survived, that little slice of the story has not been told. And the people who did that, you know, me but many, many others, I think that's a story that should probably get told. So I suggested that to the Air and Space Museum, and then they thought it'd be a good idea. So now I'm learning all the things that I didn't, all of us on our own path through life see about this much of what's going on around us, so I'm having a great fun seeing what the rest of the world was and how it looked to people who were on the journey with me at the time, but seeing it from a different vantage point.
Well, since you're writing about Hubble, and it focuses away from Earth, how is Hubble today? Hubble's health is always, because Hubble needed that repair in the beginning.
Hubble needed all the repairs. We put Hubble into orbit in 1990 for a 15-year design life. So you can check the square and say, I did my thing in 2005. And it's 2017, and it's still going quite strong. It will, at some point, probably one or two more gyros will fail, and then it just won't be able to point steadily enough to do its real workhorse astronomy. But it's 12 extra years into its design life, which is a pretty good track record.
And I should mention too, we do have some Hubble servicing tools here in this exhibit. So some of those things that you were probably involved in thinking about and preparing for are here in the exhibition. And I'd encourage everybody to go take a look at those before they leave, for sure.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's all for us. I want to thank all of you for joining us, and of course, thank our sponsor for What's New in Aerospace, Boeing. And I want to invite all of you to join me in thanking Dr. Kathy Sullivan for joining us today.
My pleasure. Thank you.